One of the most anticipated developments in recent astronomy has been the advent of what used to be called the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, or LSST, now known officially as the Vera Rubin Observatory in Chile. It has arrived and is in its calibration and testing phase, but that has not stopped it from already, basically from the moment they first turned it on, returning beautiful images of the sky in the southern hemisphere, but also an outright shocking scientific result as well that speaks volumes to the capabilities of this telescope. This is a very important instrument. And here is that result. In a single week, studying a small area of the sky, it has already discovered 2,104 new asteroids. That's right, 2,104 in a single week that we did not previously know existed. That's a mind-boggling result for something intended as a test. The intent of the telescope when it begins its normal science operations is to conduct a sky survey of unprecedented detail over a decade, to create basically what will amount to a time-lapse record of the southern sky with all images repeated every few days. In other words, in a time-lapse video, it's very easy to spot things that move, and that includes asteroids, comets, Planet 9, if it's out there, new minor planets, and interstellar objects, along with data that can be used by astronomers working in things like monitoring variable stars and much more. The survey itself is called the Legacy Survey of Space and Time, which incidentally is also somewhat poetically abbreviated as LSST, and is located high in the Andes Mountains to get it above much of the atmosphere, which these mountains get up there in height near to the level of the Himalayas for mountains on land. And this particular part of the Andes is in a weirdly non-volcanic area, because the Pacific tectonic plate is sliding under the South American plate at an angle too shallow to cause volcanism. While the observatory itself is called Vera Rubin after the eminent astronomer that studied galaxy rotation rates that ultimately led to the discovery of severe gravitational anomalies that led to the formulation of the dark matter hypothesis, the telescope itself is actually known as the Simonyi Survey Telescope after major private donors, and it sports an 8.4-meter telescope that photographs the entire sky every few nights, with a very wide field of view, yet at very high resolution with a 3.2-gigapixel CCD camera, which is the largest digital camera ever built. The telescope should begin normal science operations later this year, which is going to be interesting because this telescope is specifically designed to spot motion and look for transient astronomical phenomena in a repeating survey format. This is different from a typical telescope, which looks at a very narrow targeted field of view for a certain amount of time determined by the needs of the scientists. To get a handle on this, let's take our old friend Tabby Star as an example. So with a standard targeted telescope, it's very unlikely we would have ever known about that star's strange behavior, because firstly, it wasn't an obvious star of interest to look at. It only ever appeared in old photographic plate archives, which usually were themselves surveys, randomly photographing the sky. But it took the Kepler spacecraft to catch it. Kepler was a survey telescope in that it stared at the same patch of sky for years, taking measurements typically every half hour or so, leading to light curves of the stars within its small field of view that showed regular dips in light that indicated exoplanets. With Vera Rubin, it does the same thing at a longer cadence, but of the entirety of the sky from its perspective. That will allow that telescope to detect moving objects. And with machine learning and computing power, candidates will be discovered without anyone even seeing the raw data. Rather, the computer will see the movement and give the scientists a heads up. But that's what happened with the 2,000 asteroids in short order. Imagine what day-to-day operations will yield. But one thing is for certain. It will detect more interstellar objects, and perhaps even be useful for studying the very newly discovered third confirmed interstellar object, and potentially deepen the mystery about the already mysterious first interstellar object, Oumuamua. The new interstellar object is the third confirmed object of interstellar origin, though there are other unconfirmed candidates. Originally known as A11PL3Z, the object has now been formally named 3I Atlas as an interstellar object, and C2025N1 Atlas as a comet, which is what the object appears to be, but that's not so clean cut, and there are mysteries afoot there. More on that in a bit. It was discovered on July 1st, 2025 by Atlas, the Asteroid Terrestrial Impact Last Alert System, also in Chile, at a distance of 4.5 astronomical units from the Sun. And importantly, it's on its way into the solar system, whereas Oumuamua was only spotted on its way out, opening the way for robust observation of it. How objects are determined to be of interstellar origin is their speed. They are moving too fast to be bound to the Sun, known as a hyperbolic trajectory. But this particular object is moving extremely fast compared to the other two confirmed interstellar objects at 61 kilometers a second. Far too fast for us to catch up with it using a probe, unlike Oumuamua, which is more possible. The size of the object is not well constrained because it is an active outgassing comet, and as a result surrounded by a shell of gas and dust, making measurements difficult. They currently range from 0.8 to 24 kilometers, a lower number being more likely. The reason for this is that 24 kilometers is huge. That's over twice the size of the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs. The rule in the universe for objects like asteroids and comets is that the larger it is, the rarer it is. Take Earth. This planet gets hit with a meter-sized asteroid several times a year, but it hasn't been hit with a 10-kilometer asteroid in 66 million years. And here is where the object starts getting slightly anomalous. We should see far more smaller interstellar objects, the size of Oumuamua and Borisov, before we ever see a very large asteroid or comet like this. Like hundreds of thousands of them before we see a large one this early in the game. We should be looking for decades, or even centuries, before we expect to see an object of this size. Yet it appears that there remains a possibility that it really is that big. The problem goes away, however, if it's merely a comet, because there the coma of the comet tricks you. It looks big, because the coma is. It basically is a cloud of dust and gas. But the comet nucleus inside is small. That would present no problem here, and the size anomaly goes away. However, two papers have come out in the rush to observe this object that seem to indicate otherwise. Links to both in the description below, along with last week's Event Horizon interview, which was on this object. Both papers present that the reddening of the object is more consistent with a trans-Neptunian object or the asteroids than it is with a comet. And since we've already seen an interstellar comet, Borisov, it looked like a normal comet should and serves as a kind of comparison. So there is the possibility here that this object could get very weird indeed. There are also oddities about the object's trajectory. It's very close to the orbital plane of the Earth, which is also a bit of an eyebrow raiser. Expect a Oumuamua-like controversy if this isn't resolved very quickly as a comet. The object will make its closest approach to the Sun on October 29th of this year, and will come within 1.358 astronomical units from the Sun, and will not pass near Earth. The speed of the object comes with some interesting implications, the first of which is its origin, which appears to be the thick galactic disk, which is home to numerous old stars. And in the case of the object, it could exceed 7 billion years old, almost twice the age of our solar system. That alone makes this object interesting. Seeing very early material in an object like this would give us insights on the makeup of a star system that formed significantly earlier than our own system, and might be poorer in certain elements than the supernova-enriched material of our solar system. It also appears that the object may be water-rich, suggesting there was no shortage of water back in those days. Water, of course, is the solvent of organic life, but that's very preliminary, and the reddening tends to suggest organic chemicals in the object, the stuff of life. The object is extremely dim at about magnitude 18 currently, so something in the reach of professional telescopes, but only the largest amateur telescopes can pick this up right now. But it should become brighter as it gets closer to the sun, so it might get into the range of most medium to large amateur telescopes. It's also really difficult to observe in any case right now because it's currently moving from our perspective across the very crowded galactic plane, currently near Sagittarius. That too will improve as the object moves. But in fact, a number of previous observations of the object earlier this year have come to light after the discovery, and it was simply not noticed in those observations due to the dense star fields of the galactic plane. It was initially suspected of being an asteroid, but later observations showed the weak coma of a comet and a tail, but that's also preliminary and in question. That actually makes it the second interstellar comet we've observed. As I mentioned, the first confirmed interstellar comet was 2I Borisov. It's uncertain what the rotation rate of the object is because it's presumably obscured by dust. However, the object shows little variation in brightness, but that only suggests that the coma enveloping it is rather uniform, though again, it doesn't quite match up on the spectral reddening aspect. There have already been numerous, indeed over 100, observations since the discovery by a number of different observatories, but the most interesting upcoming observation will be the Hubble Space Telescope on July 21st. Interestingly, those observations will not be subject to any proprietary period, as is the norm for astronomical observations on NASA telescopes. This is done to give the researchers who scheduled the observations time to prepare their findings and papers without worrying about the research getting leapfrogged. But here there is no restriction on the observations at all, so that the entire community will have immediate access to the science. But there will be many other observations, and since we spotted this object on its way into the solar system, there will be plenty of time for more observations. Interestingly, this object will actually pass somewhat close to Mars on October 3rd. This is interesting because the object won't be visible to us at its closest approach to the sun, as it will be behind the sun from our perspective. But it will be visible to Mars, and it may brighten to about magnitude 11 at that point, which puts it within observability of our spacecraft in orbit of Mars. If it works out, this will be one of the few times where our instruments at another planet made useful astronomical observations apart from their own missions. The comet will become visible to Earth in early December, and at that point, our own local telescopes can start their observations again. That also will include the Vera Rubin Observatory, which is specifically suited for interstellar objects. But here's the potentially interesting thing. As is well known, Oumuamua was rather mysterious in a number of ways that did not resemble a normal comet or asteroid. That led to the natural hypotheses spinning further and further out into territory of objects we have never seen before in nature. Not great territory to be in within science. And every single hypothesis for a natural origin has some kind of flaw. That led, of course, to the hypothesis that the object might have been of alien technological origin, but that too suffers from flaws. The truth is, we still have no real idea what that object was, but here's the thing. Everything in nature strongly tends to repeat. Almost everything we see is part of a larger statistical population of like objects. This means we should see more interstellar objects relatively often, greater than once a year, with the Vera Rubin Observatory that show the unusual characteristics of Oumuamua. If that happens, we will likely find out the nature of that object from multiple examples. But if after years of observations, nothing like Oumuamua is seen again, then that mystery will deepen further indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently excited about the age of this new interstellar object. Chances are we will see objects of this age come through again, often. And if we develop some kind of reactive craft to catch up with an interstellar object while it's close, something that's under discussion, we may learn a lot more about early star systems in the universe than anyone had previously suspected we could. Very interesting stuff. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.